we're still covering the transportation, inbound merchandise and transit. And we stopped last time at the entry at the port of destination. And we're presented with a table. What is that table? Well, that table means that you have various types of transportations, transportation inbounds that you are allowed to do. Those transportation, inbound transportation include a list of five. They're right here. Entry for immediate transportation without appraisement, which means you take it from one port to another port within the United States, and you clear it at the last port. You have a warehouse and a re-warehouse withdrawal from transportation. So in other words, what you have is you have a warehouse entry, and you would like to take it out from the warehouse and clear it at someplace else other than the port where the warehouse is located in the United States. You have warehouse, re-warehouse withdrawal for exportation and transportation for exportation, which means you take it out from warehouse and you are not planning or intending to have the product shipped to the some kind of point in the United States as a final destination, but you're rather intending it to be shipped in order to export it out of the country. Entry for transportation and exportation is the same thing as above, except it's not a warehouse. It's the stuff comes in, let's say into port A, and it is going through the United States, and it is going to exit the United States without ever entering the commerce of the United States through the port B. And entry for exportation means it's not even gonna travel through the United States, it's going to come in and come out. So those are the entry types, the inbound entry types that we have available under the code, under the part 18, Code of Federal Regulations. Now, what happens if you have the entry? We know that there is a 15-day rule, right? You have a 15-calendar-day rule. And you have 15 calendar days to make the entry, whatever it is. It can be immediate transportation, it can be consumption, it can be transportation, exportation, anything. You just have to do something within those 15 calendar days. And if you don't, it's going to go to the customs hell house called general order. General order. Think of it as customs hell because storage charges are going astronomically high. The cost of getting it out from general order, the administrative burden is going to be usually higher. So just try to stick within those 15 days if you can, by all possible means. But things happen and merchandise does not get entered within 15 calendar days. It doesn't get entered. It goes into the general order. And it stays in the general order. Now let's talk about general order a little bit. What's general order? General order is a warehouse, right? But general order in the warehouse, although it's a type of warehouse, it also refers to the broader type of inquiry. It also refers to not only to warehouse, but a period within which it can stay in that warehouse. Sometimes called a general order period, right? And the general order regulations are prescribed where? Part 127, 19 CFR, part 127. Oops. 27. All right. So let's take a look at some of them, right? So let's see, let's take a look at 127.4 and see what it says. 127.4 is called general order period defined. All right. So let's see what it says. It says the general order period is that period of time during which general order merchandise is not subject to sale. Oh. The general order period expires 6 months from the date of importation. Oh. Okay. So that's interesting. So this is where we get that 6 months, right? 6 months. 6 months from import. All right. And what else? What else is important? Not subject to sale. To sale. All right. So that's also important. Not subject to sale by whom? And how does it end up in general order in the first place? Well, because someone waived their claim, right? That you have to have to make an entry. You do not make an entry. What happens? That means you either your merchandise remains unclaimed. You do not claim your right by establishing a title, by giving appropriate paperwork, or you abandon the merchandise. I don't want the stuff. It's not mine. I ordered green markers. I didn't order black markers. So I'm not gonna worry about that stuff. This is not my stuff. So what happens to those markers that are in the general order? Well, they have to be, can they be sold? By whom and how? So we have a whole set of regulations talking about the sale, because for 6 months it sits without sale. So in other words, regulations provide for general order warehouse 6 months. For general order merchandise, 6 months. For someone to make their mind, make up their mind and say, okay, maybe I need to get it out. Maybe I really need this stuff. Or maybe I don't. So we wait 6 months, and the government waits 6 months, and then after 6 months passes by, what happens? That general order merchandise can be subject to auction sale. Place of sale, 127.22, says the port director of Customs and Border Protection in his discretion may authorize the sale of merchandise subject to sale, meaning beyond 6 months, the consignee of any merchandise to which it is transferred from the port where it was imported to another sale shall be notified, blah, blah, blah. All right. So customs can sell that stuff, right? So they sell it. Then what happens? Well, we have a whole regulation that tells about what happens. You get your money, you go to the auction sale and you buy the stuff. And the money goes to cover, guess what? Duties. But look at where the duties are, right? Duties are where at the bottom, right? Almost at the bottom. First, it goes to cover internal revenue taxes, if any. Expenses of advertising and sale, putting the auction on the bulletin board. Expenses of cartridge storage and labor, so the general order storage charges will need to be covered. And then if anything is left, it goes to duties. If anything is left, then any other charges due to the United States government. And then, of course, any sum due to satisfy a lien for freight charges and contribution in general average, which may not be applicable. So, what does that mean? That means that after 6 months, the general order merchandise can be disposed of through auction sale by customs, and the proceeds of the sale will go in to cover all those expenses, which will be plentiful. So now we have some idea about 6 months, right? We know what 6 months, where 6 months comes from, but let's look at the table, right? So we have a stuff in general order. If it is less than 6 months, not more than 6 months, less than 6 months, then you can get the stuff out of the country. You take it out of the country, you export it, you ship it back to the factory because let's say I want black markers, I don't want green markers, so there is an arrangement takes place where the stuff just gets out, goes back to wherever it came from, and a new order of conforming markers comes in. So you can export it and you can IT it, you can do anything, you can do any type. Remember those five type of inbound transportation entries we talked about? You can do any five of those and this will be good. But once you pass the 6 month period, it becomes vested in the interest of the United States government, and that interest puts a limitation, puts a cap. No, you may no longer export the stuff. No. If you want to bring it, if you want to get it out from the warehouse, assuming it has not been sold yet, you are bringing it for consumption. You pay your duties, you pay your charges, you pay the United States government fees, and only after that, after you are clear with the US government, perhaps you can get it out. But first, you have to file a consumption entry. So, the only permissible entry type for the stuff that stayed more than 6 months and became outside of the GO period, general order period, only consumption entry is permissible. And customs examiners do test on this very easy. The Foxtrot company arranges for a carrier to file an IT without appraisement for 50,000 CDs that have been in general order for over 7 months. 7 months. From the date of original importation. Upon the destination at the port of upon arrival to the port destination, what can you do? So of course the question is, can you avoid the consumption? And the answer is no, because the only thing you can do with it is consumption only, right? You cannot do exportation. So notice, you can do an IT within a country, but you cannot get it out. You can get in, but you cannot get out. Unless you clear the entry through consumption. So, A, transportation and exportation may be filed. No, that's a right of way. Exportation is not allowed. Warehouse entry may be filed. No, consumption. Anything that has no consumption has to go. IT without appraisal may be filed to move the merchandise to another port. That's kind of weird. Right? Can you file another IT to move it to another port? I mean, if you file an IT once, I don't see why can't you file an IT twice, right? What type of IT? What port? So it's kind of a candidate lurking in there, right? But remember, we're looking at the best answer, right? And the best answer is the one that closely fits the buzzwords, consumption entry only. And here the buzzword that closely approximates is stated in answer B, and entry for consumption may be filed for the shipment. This is what customers are looking for. Consumption only, consumption only. A privileged foreign merchandise FTZ entry may be filed. No. FTZ. So really the battleground is between B and D, and B wins because it's more closely approximates the best answer. So B is the correct answer choice in here. Invoice requirements. So it deals with procedure. What you have to do to enter the stuff in. And here we have the shipment that has been split. And of course, you have invoice covering various shipments, which happens. And because we know from our entry discussion that split shipments are possible. And you do not have to recreate your invoice, you just have to apportion the invoice.